So my name is Rimma. I'm an architect and a product manager on Cosmos DB. I'm going to speak for about 15 minutes and just give you a little bit of an idea of what is Cosmos DB, how does it actually work behind the scenes. And then Mikhail is going to show how to build apps, planet scale apps using Cosmos. So roughly, introduction, system model, global distribution. We'll talk a little bit about resource governance and conclusion. That's my part. And then Mikhail will jump in. So we started Cosmos DB actually about 9 years ago inside Microsoft, and originally it was known as Project Florence. Those of you who have ever been to Florence, there is this famous dome, which is viewed as basically the beginning of the Renaissance. And we wanted to start the Renaissance for data, that's why we named it Florence. We made the service generally available in 2017. It is classified as a ring zero or foundation service inside Azure. What that simply means is it's automatically available in all of the Azure regions by default. So whenever we announce a region, whether it's a public, it's a sovereign cloud, it's a government cloud, we have to be automatically there because there are other services that are built on top of us. So we're serving now about tens of trillions of requests per day. Given that we already announced a region in Africa, you can actually take your Cosmos account and span it across all of the seven continents worldwide. So basically create a database that is spanning across North America, Africa, Asia Pacific, and still view it as a single system image database. Inside Microsoft, it's also became ubiquitous. Services like Office 365, Xbox, Universal Store, Teams, LinkedIn, and now we're also onboarding GitHub and a bunch of other projects. So when we started Cosmos DB, we wanted to build the database designed for the cloud. In a sense, if you were to forget about 40 years of legacy COD relational databases, how would you design a cloud-native data platform? And ultimately, we wanted to provide capabilities such as global distribution, because cloud is ubiquitous, so your database, your data platform should be ubiquitous wherever your users are. Second is provide the elasticity and unlimited scalability with respect to two dimensions, both storage as well as throughput. So you should be able to elastically go from just a few gigabytes into terabytes and eventually scale into petabytes. And then orthogonal to that, your computational needs may vary over a period of time. So in retail, phenomenon like Black Friday, Cyber Monday, all of a sudden you have a burst in traffic. When you launch a game, you want that game to be successful, so you have a lot of users coming in and you want to elastically scale up. So you want the data platform that can elastically scale with your workload needs. And last but not the least is provide the cost efficiencies with very fine-grained multi-tenancy and resource governance. This is the ability to basically take multiple tenants, densely pack them on the commodity hardware, provide this resource isolation with adaptive resource governance and performance isolation, and provide the guarantees in terms of performance. So these were kind of like the three core principles that we had in mind when we started the service. Now the design goals were, number one is to elastically scale throughput on demand across any number of Azure regions around the world within 5 seconds at the 99th percentile. The other thing is also to provide a near real-time access to your data. So what that means is deliver less than 10 milliseconds end-to-end client-server read and write latencies. On average, it's actually a lot faster. For reads, you will see somewhere between 1 to 3 milliseconds. For writes, it will be somewhere between 4 to 5 milliseconds. Offer 5 nines read and write high availability. Provide tunable consistency models for developers. So this is known as gap theorem trade-offs or pass-up trade-offs. Being able to pick precisely the right trade-off in terms of performance and the trade-off not just with respect to high availability, but also latency and throughput as well. And operate at low cost, that's a no-brainer, obviously. And then last but not the least is provide strict performance isolation between both transactions transactional as well as analytical workloads. So something that we will announce very soon, it's already in preview, is being able to run analytics at global scale as well. And last but not least, is also build the schema agnostic engine to support basically unbounded schema version. So this is ultimately what it resulted in. So given all of these design goals, at the end of the day, we have a core, the core of the service, which is providing the capabilities like global distribution, elastic scale out, guaranteed low latency anywhere around the world, fault consistency model, SLAs. We also give you the multiple data models to work with. Because they're built on top of the same core, all of these properties are applicable to graph, to JSON documents, to column family, key value, and whatnot. And ultimately, to access your data, you should be able to pick the API of your choice, because we want to meet developers wherever they're coming from, and give you the experience, or your applications, the experience as if they're talking to native Mongo or native Cassandra, but ultimately they're taking advantage of the cloud native database. So if you're coming from relational background, we have a SQL API. If you're coming from Mongo background, we give you via protocol compatible Mongo API. If you're using Apache Cassandra, we give you Cassandra API. This one, you saw the presentation on the etcd. This is the ability to take these capabilities and take them to Kubernetes. So Kubernetes becomes globally distributed with automatic failover, with the multi-master capabilities, and ultimately the SLAs. And this one is the ability to be able to run operational and real-time analytics anywhere around the world, because Spark is co-located with your globally distributed database. So what is the system model? Let me quickly walk through it. This is a beautiful slide, but ultimately the tenants, the customers, they bring their data. The data could be, depending on the data model, could be either tables or collections or graph. We call them Cosmos containers. Disclaimer, it has nothing to do with Kubernetes containers, it has nothing to do with Docker containers. We were not very creative in terms of naming, so we call them Cosmos containers. Ultimately, this is your unit of horizontal scalability. You pick a partition key, and then we perform the sharding in terms of local distribution within the region, and then global distribution across multiple regions. So customers can associate, let me just quickly go through this. So customers can associate one or more Azure regions with their Cosmos account, and then we perform the global replication across multiple regions. Supported APIs are Mongo, Cassandra, SQL, Gremlin, and all of these capabilities are applicable to all of them. The containers themselves, think of them, they're completely schema agnostic bags of data. So whatever the data you throw at Cosmos, it will happily absorb it and automatically index all of the entities that it's So what does the system actually look like behind the scene? This is actually the physical view, so that you don't think it's magic. But so you take Earth, you know, planet. These are Azure regions. We have we're running today across 54 regions worldwide, and the control plane is basically bootstrapped in a data center via this control plane. The control plane itself is fully decentralized, and its state is also replicated inside the Cosmos DB itself. So we can go and basically scale it across the planet. If you zoom in on Azure regions, within the regions you'll find the data centers. This is where we have the data center load balancer. Within the data centers, we're running across about 11 to 20 full domains. So if there is a partial outage, or somebody cuts a cord, or something happens, tornado, hurricane, your replicas and your partitions are distributed across different full domains and availability zones. Then you zoom in on the racks of clusters, you'll find here clusters, both compute and storage. If you zoom in on the individual machine, this is where containers that belong to different tenants are co-residing on exactly the same machines. So this is multi-tenancy at play. With the proper resource isolation, we can densely pack containers that belong to multiple tenants on the same machines and perform give them resource isolation. So the containers themselves are comprised out of replicas. If you zoom in on the replica, it basically has a co-located database engine, admission control, resource governor. And within the database engine itself, you'll find the typical components of a database engine. plus a lot of other interesting stuff that we've added. One is the actual storage engine, the fact that we're storing index row store and column store, optimized for both operational as well as analytical workloads. So the global distribution, this is the experience that we provide to the users. You can come in, click on replicate data globally. We provide you with the world map, and you select where you want your data to be. Then you click a save button, and that's it. So at any point in time, you don't need to pause your application, you don't need to redeploy it. You select the regions where you want you to be, and that's it. You can also specify the priority list of the regions so that in the unlikely event, if there is a disaster, let's assume there is a regional outage, basically all of your writes will automatically flip over to the secondary region in the priority list that you specify. Okay? So this is what we call turnkey global distribution by virtue of just turning on what you want your data to be. Behind the scenes, this is a little bit of the insights, but you can think of it. Partition is basically the basic Lego block for your data. When you go partition your containers, we shard them using partition keys. Each partition is represented by a quorum of replicas that is represented by where the data is stored in both analytical and transactional data store. We dynamically self-adjust membership and quorums. We have built-in resource governance, leader-follower election, and we enable basically the very flexible split and merge the global replication of these partition sets. This is what the actual global distribution looks like. If we go and look at our telemetry, it's basically a graph that is spreading across, and you can see basically all of the reads and writes are always local to the region where you So you should always co-locate your Kubernetes or your Azure functions with the region where that is associated with your Cosmos database. That's how you get the lowest latency. It's multi-mastered, so your reads and writes are always happening locally. So we provide the guaranteed RPO and RTO of zero. The SDKs that we provide are multi-homing aware. So if there is a regional outage, the SDK client is intelligent enough to be able to go navigate to a secondary region and be able to route the request. So as far as your application tier, it's completely oblivious to potential regional failures or you adding and removing regions. You may only notice the impact on the latency. This is the consistency models. So if you're really fascinated about this subject, if you look at the traditional market of operational databases, you will typically notice what we call a very extreme binary choice. On the other hand, most traditional databases give you strong consistency with its own trade-offs of higher latency, lower availability, but we get the perfect consistency. Most traditional NoSQL systems give you eventual. Cosmos DB gives you also the three intermediate consistency models. We actually have TLA plus specs for all of the consistency models on GitHub, so you guys can go check them out. And it basically gives you a very programmable and very well-defined options in terms of navigating precise trade-offs in terms of performance, latency, consistency, and availability with failures or network partitions, anything like that, so you can pick the right trade-offs. So resource governance, this is another very important component of the system. Ultimately, so Cosmos DB goes with a provision throughput model, very similar to what DynamoDB offers, but the difference here is our request units abstract basically physical resources like percentage of memory, percentage of CPU, percentage of IOPS, and then they're applicable to all operations that you're running. So you don't need to do separate capacity management for reads or for writes. All of them are applicable to all of the database operations that you're running. Behind the scene, basically, your replicas that belong to the partition get allotted a budget of RUs. And we provide basically resource governance to guarantee that when you ask that you want to perform 10,000 transactions per second, you have these resources fully allocated to you and they're completely ring-fenced from all the other tenants. So you are getting the resources that you got. Okay? This is actually just, I took the snapshot from about 2 years ago. Now it's a lot, much, much larger numbers, but you can see just the scale that we're running in. Within a matter of 3 days, we're supporting services running 3 trillion transactions in just 3 days. This is a telemetry view. Zooming in on one of the clusters. This is multi-tenancy in real life. So think of it this way. These are the clusters that are in region central US with the replicas and partitions belonging to different tenants co-located on the same cluster serving the data in real time. This is zooming in on the individual machine, how we go and partition resources and allocate them to different tenants, and within a single machine, how the resources are properly isolated to serve the requests to the tenants. So, in conclusion, Cosmos is Microsoft's globally distributed database service. It's one of the Azure, foundational Azure services. We've battle tested it massively with our internal workloads. Multi-master replication, global distribution, fine-grained resource governance, partition management are the core foundational principle of the service. And then the precisely defined multiple consistency models provide you with clear trade-offs for your data. The SLAs and the latency and the throughput availability is something that we as the engineers inside Cosmos are super, super proud of. It took almost 10 years to get to that level, but this is really exciting. We're also hiring, so if you are excited about this mission, looking for cosmonauts, you can go to the site joincosmosdb.com and I will pass it on now to Mikhail, who will show how to use Cosmos to build events and serverless applications.